Books on Tape presents There's a Slight Chance I Might Be Going to Hell, a novel of sewer pipes, pageant queens, and big trouble, by Laurie Notaro, read by Susan Denaker. Prologue. Spring, 1956. The moment the girl stepped onto the stage, the circle of a spotlight swung toward her, announcing her presence above the audience in a sheer, clean illumination. The crowd before her suddenly quieted, as if expecting something truly spectacular to occur. It would have to be spectacular. After all, Mary Lou Winton, the contestant before her, had let loose a greased baby pig on stage, which she managed to lasso, hogtie, and brand with a branding iron fashioned to look like a sewer pipe, no less, in a definitive 9 seconds flat. It was, in fact, confirmed by the audience, who counted down as Mary Lou whipped that rope and then stomped over to plunge the glowing iron. And it was further rumored that Ruth Watson was planning to bring her rifle out onto the stage and shoot every winged fowl right out of the sky, all in her evening gown attire for her talent segment. Farm antics, the girl scoffed to herself, wondering if such a thing really could be considered as a talent or just an episode of unfortunate breeding. She knew she could not let any of that concern her as she looked out over the crowd, searching the faces. She knew almost everyone, everyone who was waiting to hear her sing. She smiled softly, an expression that seemed gentle. If only I had ruby slippers, she thought to herself. The light that would have caught them would have been astounding. The sparkle would have bounced off of them like rockets, far more impressive than an oily piglet or dead birds. She looked down at her feet, at her pair of last year's Sunday shoes, now buffed a bright cherry red by her father, who had been so proud when he surprised her with them, and saw that they did not sparkle, but produced a dull, minuscule shine. Behind her, she heard Mrs. A. Melrose from the church choir begin playing the piano. This was her cue, and the pianist had better keep time. Although she considered herself a devoted Christian woman overflowing with generosity, Mrs. Melrose thought little of donating her time to the endeavor and suggested that instead she exchange her musical services for the girls scrubbing a week's worth of the accompanist's and her flatulent husband's laundry. Despite the gruesome task that lay ahead in the Melrose's wash bin the next day, the girl continued to smile as she drew a deep, full breath, so full that the replica blue gingham pinafore fashioned from a picnic tablecloth seemed to expand slightly, making the ketchup stains that stubbornly remained on the cloth look like she had encountered Ruth Watson's rifle. She waited. One, two, three. The next note was hers. She was ready. Somewhere over the rainbow. Her voice glided sweetly over the stage into the audience and twirled in the air above them like magic. She could see it on the faces of the people watching her, listening to her, heads tilted slightly to the side as they smiled back at her. This was no pig-roping event, and no explosion of feathers was going to trickle down from the clouds. This was talent. I have it, she thought giddily to herself as she finished the first verse, as her voice continued on clear, strong, and with the right touch of delicacy. It is mine. She saw him standing in the back, far beyond the crowd assembled in the square. The most handsome man she had ever seen in real life, the one who could save her. With a bouquet spilling with flowers in the crook of his arm, he leaned up against his brand new powder blue Packard Caribbean convertible with its white wall tires and gleaming curvaceous chrome bumpers. It was a glorious machine. It suited him. Cars like that were rare in this town, and so were the men they suited. She saw him smiling at her, and to her he delivered a nod of encouragement. She felt herself blush a shade. The surge of delight was just the push she needed to soar into the last verse and deliver with earnest, heartfelt yearning, "Why, oh, why can't I?" The moment the last note evaporated into the air, the crowd burst forth with a shower of applause, the hands of the audience clapping heartily. And as she looked toward the back of the crowd, she saw that he was clapping too, his arms full of tulips, roses, and lilies. Clapping for her. Excitement raced up her spine like a block shooting up to hit the bell on a high-striker carnival game. It was hers. She had done it. She knew it. She owned it. She could actually feel the weight of the crown being placed on her head. She could foresee the way that it would sparkle. She wanted it to sparkle brightly, feverishly, ferociously. Sparkle so bright it would blind them. Show this town that she was the queen of this scrap heap, this tiny little town with nothing in it but sewer pipes and waste. From this moment, it was all hers, all of it. If she wanted ruby slippers, she would get ruby slippers. Not last year's fake, cheap Sunday shoes painted red with a dirty rag. She was more than that. It was hers, the crown, the town. She had won and she would take it. She knew it like she had never known anything else. As if there was any other choice, the pig tosser, the bird slayer. This was now her town, her kingdom, to reign as she saw fit. She smiled sweetly again, then closed her eyes slowly, laid her arm over her chest, holding her hand to her heart the way she had seen it done in the movies, and crossed one leg deeply behind the other in what could only be described as a true queenly and magnificent gesture. And with that, she took a bow. Chapter 1. The Queen Leaves the Hive. Every morning on her daily trip to the dumpster behind Starbucks, Maye made sure she was wearing lipstick and carrying her lucky stick. Perched on an overturned milk crate, she used the former broom handle to poke at the trash with one hand while batting away the flies with the other. It was searing hot. Within minutes, Maye could feel the relentless phoenix sun bearing down on the crown of her head and the flush of sweat trickling down her temples and detouring into her eyes, making them burn with salt. She poked on with her lucky stick, overturning a piece of cardboard to reveal an almost uneaten enchilada dinner from Starbucks' neighbor, Don Juan's Taco Village, resting perfectly atop an empty solo cup box. "Bingo," she sang, smiling like the Cheshire Cat as she reached over to snatch the styrofoam plate from its spot. "Come to Mama." She rose up on tippy-toe as her outstretched arm grazed the blazing metal side of the dumpster, causing her to flinch slightly. "I am going to get you," she hissed, determined to reach the objective. From her vantage point, it looked to be a cheese enchilada and a beef taco with rice and beans, as she stretched as far as she could, her fingers now brushing the pearly white dish. With only one foot now balancing on the milk crate, Maye leaned as deeply into the dumpster as she could, and with one determined push, grabbed the dinner, the cheese on the refried beans still soft in the bubbling summer heat, and pulled herself out of the metal bin without spilling so much as a drop of the red, runny enchilada sauce. Maye heard the creak of metal hinges as a door opened behind her. "Hey!" a loud voice shouted. With the entree in her hands, she turned around to face a young man wearing a green barista's apron. "You don't need to dig around in there," the young man said. "I've got something for you here."
"I was wondering where you were," Maye replied.
"I was here on time." She turned on the milk crate and with a little hop, lobbed the dinner square back into the dumpster, and with her lucky stick in hand, turned her attention to the perfect four-sided, undented, untorn, and unstained with enchilada sauce solo box that was exactly the size she needed to hold her food processor.
She beamed as she lifted it from the bin. "Thanks, Carlos. I'll take whatever you've got," May replied as she gazed admiringly at her find. "But this one is perfect. A beauty like this would be $7 at U-Haul. But I wish those Don Juan kids would get their recycling and trash bins straight. You don't know how."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.